Chief Minister of Madhya Pradesh and Chief Mentor of IMT, Shri Kamalnath Ji, Director of IMT Nagpur, Dr. Bhattacharya, distinguished members of the faculty, the graduating class of 2019, proud parents, ladies and gentlemen. It is a pleasure for me to address all of you at the 14th convocation ceremony of the IMT Nagpur. This is my first visit here and I'm delighted to see this lush green campus. I have very fond memories of addressing the graduating class of IMT Ghaziabad way back in 2003. And I must compliment Kamalnath Ji and the board of IMT for their leadership in imparting management students with education that is relevant in the world of business today. In just a little over 30 years, I see that IMT as a brand has carved a niche for itself in management education with four campuses, including one internationally in Dubai. To the class of 2019, I can tell you that there is no better time than now to start your career. It doesn't matter whether you join a big Indian company or an MNC giant, whether you join a startup, or if you're starting up yourself. India presents the most compelling opportunity. All of you armed with a coveted degree are best placed to make it count. But success, as we know, doesn't come easy. To quote the German philosopher Friedrich Nietzsche, he said, "He who would learn to fly one day must first learn to stand and walk and run and climb and dance. One cannot fly into flying," unquote. So the question then is that how do we get you to fly? Luckily for you though, I see that you need to look no further than your own institute's values charter to understand the foundation of which success always stands on. A strong foundation of values, I believe, is always at the bedrock of success. I can't stress enough on the primacy of values. For us in ABG2, these are cardinal. They are our anchor, they are our North Star. They define who we are and what we do. Which is why I was delighted to see that the five values your institute stands for: integrity, collective decision making, academic freedom, compassion with commitment, and sensitivity to sustainability resonates so strongly with the Aditya Birla Group's own stated values. Given that you have invested 2 years of your lives imbibing these values, I thought I would explain to you the relevance of these very values in the context of the corporate world that several of you will be entering maybe tomorrow. So first up, there is integrity. And incidentally, this value also comes right on top of our own value charter at the Aditya Birla Group. I'm going to use the words of the legendary investor Warren Buffett to stress on the need for integrity. He said, and I quote, "In looking for people to hire, you look for three qualities: integrity, intelligence, and energy. And if they don't have the first, the other two will kill you," unquote. Simply put, without integrity, you just don't stand a chance. At the Aditya Birla Group, we have defined integrity as acting and making decisions in a manner that is fair and honest. So how does one break it down in terms of everyday behavior? Very simple. Let me give you a few examples. Admitting to and accepting responsibility for mistakes is an act of integrity, according to me. But equally, taking credit for others' work is an act of dishonesty. Similarly, in my book, compromising the organization's interest for personal gain or using the resources of the firm for personal benefit demonstrates lack of integrity. I want you to pause and think about this. Some of this behavior is so commonplace, it's seen as being so innocuous, and yet it is this behavior that defines the culture of an organization. Remember that every time someone engages in an act of dishonesty, they don't stop there. They give themselves the license to do it again and again. Back to the values charter and to the second one that has so much relevance to the world of business, and that is collective decision making, which I would call teamwork. Legendary basketball player Michael Jordan, who we have all heard of summed it up so beautifully when he said, and I quote, "Talent wins games, but teamwork and intelligence win championships," unquote. Individual brilliance can only take you so far. From business to any other field, I believe strongly that teamwork is the key to success. So many of you might ask, how does teamwork matter in an individual sport like tennis? When we talk about tennis, we think about Federer and Nadal and nothing beyond them. But I would say that teamwork works with them as much as it would do in a team sport. From the coaching staff, to the physio, to the fitness trainer, they all form part of the winning team, even though they are not visible. They are the unseen heroes without whom a Federer would not be what he is today. The contribution of a team, always remember, that is oftentimes less visible, is no less valuable. Let me give you another example from the Aditya Birla Group itself. A few years ago, Egypt, home to two of our companies, was under a revolutionary siege. Anarchy seemed like the order of the day. The management there had to grapple with two key issues. One was a continued threat to the life and to the life of employees, both expats and the locals, expats in this case being the Indians, and of course running the plant in the face of such uncertainty, unable to meet the commitments we'd made to our customers. Our employees worked shoulder to shoulder to keep the operations going. The expats, which is the Indians, didn't want to desert the locals in this hour of strife, and so together they fought anarchy with complete order. They chose to stay on and work with the locals there and not fly back home, which they could so easily have done. It doesn't matter if you are the chairman of a $45 billion conglomerate or a management trainee in a new age internet consumer company, if you cannot collaborate, you cannot succeed. To me personally, the joy of accomplishing something as a team is much, much more than an individual achievement. Speaking from my own experience, I can say that there are three key factors that are critical to building cohesive and strong teams. First, a common direction or vision that has to bind the team together. Once that is in place, comes the most crucial ingredient, which is that of mutual trust. The moment there is mutual trust in the team, then its members can thrive even in an atmosphere of pressure and conflict. Finally, unrelenting focus on high performance. The culture of the team must be one that recognizes and rewards high performance. So to summarize, a winning team to me is a bunch of talented people who are high performers, who have mutual trust, and who coalesce to achieve a common objective. From teamwork, we move on to a value that your institute's charter speaks about in a way that is relevant to a business context. I'm talking about academic freedom, which in the business context is what we would call constructive dissent. By constructive dissent, I mean the freedom to speak up against ideas that you don't agree with. I believe that the culture of yes men and yes women is toxic to the growth of any company. The management philosophy of the leader has to be to evolve from command and control to discuss and then decide. Let me explain this. The command and control style of leadership is authoritative in nature, as you would have learned, and uses a top-down approach to decision-making. This may have well been effective in the past or in a bureaucratic setup, but it is certain to fail in what I call the firm of the future. Such firms will thrive on a collaborative approach to decision making. Such firms would typically have some amount of creative tension, as I call it, that ensures that the best decisions are taken through a process of open discussion, debate, and then alignment. So let me give you an example from our own group. A metals company, Hindalco, was weighing a bid for Novelis, a company twice its size, headquartered in the US, at a value of $6 billion. Not everyone in the leadership team was convinced. I would say, in fact, that it was a divided house with several leaders raising some valid points of concern. I then got the entire leadership team together and we sat down and thrashed out every single concern before going ahead with the acquisition. Painstaking effort went into building a consensus, but it was well worth it. From that incident, I learned that a good leader is one who provides the space for different and differing views and yet has the ability to get the team to rally around whatever the final decision is. So employees must have the freedom to express their points of view and the discipline to execute as per the decision of the team with total commitment. And I hope that you will always remember that. Compassion with commitment is your institute's next value that resonates with us too. Service to society is at the core of the values of our group. Giving and caring, in fact, is part of the Birla DNA right from the time of my great-grandfather, the legendary G.D. Birla. It has since been institutionalized through the Aditya Birla Center for Community Initiatives and Rural Development. We work, as was mentioned, in 5,000 villages to make a life-changing difference to 8 million people worldwide every year. We engage in providing health care, education, sustainable livelihood, supporting infrastructure development and social reform. This giving back to society is a very integral part of our DNA. It is a value that I prize above all others. It implies not just being kind, but giving beyond, giving opportunities, getting opportunities, making use of opportunities, much beyond just making money or a name for oneself. It's a chance to make a difference to the world that we live in. I also believe that compassion with commitment infuses a larger purpose to life. The teachings of the Buddha tell us that thousands of candles can be lit from a single candle, and yet the life of that candle is not shortened. The art of giving, we believe, generates a new level of energy that is perhaps more powerful than nuclear fusion. Every generation must look beyond themselves and reach out to the underprivileged. Leave the world a better and safer place for the next generation. Your parents and your institute have tried to do that by giving you values and the best education here. It is now your payback time. Begin with small steps and scale up gradually as you rise in position with compassion and commitment, both as your tailwinds. And finally, the one value which will hold us all in good stead tomorrow, sensitivity to sustainability. I'm delighted to see that IMT is walking the talk on sustainability. I was told that this institute has established a full-fledged solar panel system across the campus in order to make it more energy efficient. At the Aditya Birla Group, we have laid out a vision for the group to become the leading Indian conglomerate for sustainable practices of business across our global operations. Our group company, Novelis, that I spoke about earlier, is in the business of downstream aluminium rolled products. It recycles more than 65 billion used cans every year, turning them back into new beverage cans in roughly 60 days. Think about the benefits of recycling. It conserves natural resources, reduces energy consumption, cuts greenhouse gases, and saves landfill space. Now think about the last time that you drank a can of Coke or any other aerated drink. Did you even care to check if it was made from recycled material? Or did you find a way to recycle it after it was used? So it eventually boils down to each one of us making choices to promote sustainable living. Sustainability, I must stress, is no longer tomorrow's problem. The sinking of land and coastlines, the impact of ebbing or rising tides, the melting of glaciers are all a reality today. India now needs a new cohort of leaders who are willing to put sustainability first. The businesses you create, the actions you take, all need to be thought through the lens of sustainability. Dear students, I'm sure that many of you have landed your dream jobs. It could be with a consulting firm or a conglomerate or even an exciting startup. There may be some of you who have not quite cracked these so-called marquee jobs. Please remember This is just the starting point. You're running a marathon. Michael Dell's first job was of a dishwasher when he was just 12. 7 years later, when he was 19, he formed Dell Corporation, and by the time he got to 27, he was running a Fortune 500 company. So don't judge yourself by the salary you draw, the firm you work for, or the designation that will flash in your soon-to-be printed visiting card. In due time, you will realize that there is more to your career and way more to your life than your first job. Along with that realization, I hope that you don't forget to repay this institution that has landed you your first job to start with. And the best way that you can honor your B school is by living its values every day in the workplace. The ultimate glory you can bring to your beloved institute is by being its best brand ambassador in corporate India. To conclude, I'm going to turn to Oscar Wilde and his famous quote, and I quote, "Be yourself, everyone else is already taken," unquote. There is a premium to being authentic today. Never lose an opportunity to learn, but equally, always stay true to yourself. Congratulations, good luck, and Godspeed.